viewers can see the most positive and joyous aspects of things, and he's open to it. And that's why those pictures look the way they do, because he will find the humane element.
Bruce Davidson has an eye which just captures great clarity in the world around him. His prints always have the sense of being bright and clear and open and reflecting back or drawing in the sunlight and the light from the people in his images.
People say, oh, you're a documentary photographer. I don't even know what that means. Oh, you're a photojournalist. I don't know what that means. I rarely am published in journals. They say, oh, well, then you're a fine art photographer. I said, no, I'm not a fine art photographer. I aspire to be a fine photographer. I photographed for months, sometimes years, same thing. In 1958, I traveled with the Clyde Beatty Circus, a small tent show. I photographed it 4 months. And then my encounter with the Brooklyn Gang. After the gang photographs in 59, I began to photograph the civil rights movement. Then I proceeded to photograph in the South for 4 years. East 100th Street was 2 years. The subway was a year. Central Park was 4 years. There were times when I went roaming the park day and night before I began to come to into a kind of focus, into kind of a balance with the park. When I work, it isn't as if I know what I'm doing. There were times when I stood next to a rock that I liked for hours, till somebody or something came along.
I'm looking for a friend of mine here. Yeah, did you know Ed Bragg, Bigfoot they called him? He used to live here, live in a park for about 6 years.
I think he died.
Did he die?
I think so.
Oh, really? You know what I mean.
Yeah.
Guy from Tennessee.
Yeah, he died.
He had a cough. He smoked a lot.
He died about two half a year ago. I know you're talking about.
Yeah. He was a friend of mine. So yeah. I spent about 4 years in here photographing in the park.
Yeah, you could be about 72nd.
Exactly. That was a summer resident. Then he went, stayed in the
down. He knows below. Everybody.
Those are great looking shoes you have.
He's not going up to somebody and throwing a camera in their face and then never seeing them again.
Yeah, he
spent a very long time getting their trust.
I'll tell you
and
what.
He didn't betray that trust in any way. I know he gives them photographs.
I always carry a little portfolio with me.
It's a good-looking rock here.
Lean back or just...
Yeah, just relax. Just relax. Just be yourself. This is a time exposure, old-fashioned like camera picture. It's an interesting word, contact. I guess that's what my photographs are about. Contact.
Bruce processes his film himself and then does spend endless hours in the darkroom making sure that his prints represent what he saw when his original image was conceived.
This is like returning to the womb, only it's better because you know what you're doing. Brooklyn Gang was photographed in 1959, 40 years later. I went back and I edited 60 photographs no one has ever seen before. Simultaneously, Benji, Bobby Powers, the leader of the gang who I hadn't seen or heard from in 40 years, called me up out of the blue.
This is Bobby.
Remember me, Benji?
I've been hearing about these pictures for 30 years. People saw them at different places. And people do remember, people from the neighborhood do remember Bruce.
How are you?
Because he was interested in us, as just as people, and he was nice. He was nice to us.
Yeah, you had your hands a certain way in those days. That's it. Brooklyn Gang wasn't about violence, but it was about feeling and the sense of their deep depression and anxiety and fear, and at the same time, incredible vitality. The young women in that group were beautiful. The guys were great looking. I remember a photograph I made of Benji standing against a wall in a kind of a little candy store. And I saw such incredible tension and anxiety in his face. He almost looked like an old man.
I see some of the pictures of me, and it just tells me how sad I really was, you know? I mean, that's the way I see them, the pictures, you know? Like a lost 15-year-old kid.
With all the projects he's done, you really feel that it's become his life. I mean, that's part of the energy that you sense, and it's part of what makes the images so compelling.
That was the amazing thing about the World War. No matter how sunny it was out, people spread the
editing process is a very important process. I usually work with Emily, my dear wife of 30 years.
I look at this picture now as being a little trite.
Sometimes you take out one picture, it locks everything else in.
You see, actually, the book opens up. You see, that's not the whole picture. The sense of space, that's the space of life.
What I'm trying to do, what I would like to do, is keep my life in balance, where I'm walking the streets with my little handheld camera, where I sense things, feel things, discover things, interact with people. Discover, question, know, learn, understand. And then I come back into my little darkroom and make the images of those impressions that I experience during the day. It feels like it's a whole life. Now it starts here. I like to make the master prints. Those are prints that have the feel that I would like. This creation from a blank piece of paper set in some kind of a solution to an image that can be made permanent and fixed is very basic and universal and probably it hasn't changed in my mind since the first day that I made a print and saw this image emerge out of nothing when I was 10 years old. The excitement of seeing that image evolve is quite special.
Emmy, I'm ready for lunch.